Our scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 104, 24 through 34, and can be found on page 633 in most of the Pew Bibles. How many are your works, O Lord? In wisdom you made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There is the sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both large and small. There are ships go to and from, and the Leviathan, which you form to frolic there. These all look to you to give them food at the proper time. When you give it to them, they gather it up. When you open your hand, they are satisfied with good things. When you hide your face, they are terrified. When you take away their breath, they die and return to the dust. When you send your spirit, they are created, and you renew the face of the earth. May the glory of the Lord endure forever. May the Lord rejoice in his works. He who looks at the earth and it trembles, who touches the mountains and they smoke. I will sing to the Lord all my life. I will sing praise to my God as long as I live. May my meditation be pleasing to him as I rejoice in the Lord. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word.
According to our church calendar, today marks the end of Easter. Doesn't it seem like it's been so long ago? The tomb is gone. You noticed when you came in this morning, our tomb has been removed. And in the tomb's place is our blankets for Church World Service. If you take time to look at especially the orange or yellow blanket, whatever color you want to call it, how many squares are on it, Judy?
151.
151 squares, representing how many blankets have been purchased by this congregation.
Oh.
We have moved from Easter, where we stood by and watched, and we've moved into a time where we have started to step up and to serve as God's people. We ourselves have been transformed from those who the word of truth was taught to, now are the teachers of that truth. We use Lent to take inventory of our own souls. We did some soul searching and reflection and some meditation. We shared six different kinds of bread together, and we were reminded of Jesus' desire for us as believers, as disciples. He called for us to be hospitable to other travelers, giving of ourselves without them asking or without looking for payment. He called us into a time of chaos when we would accept the fact that God himself would take what we had and put it together and would make something beautiful out of it. Jesus taught us that we need to be ready, like the Israelites, to pack up and go anywhere, anytime for his sake, and to carry with us the bread for the journey, the unleavened bread, the bread that we could make quickly, but yet that bread that would sustain us. We were taught how God provided manna from the heavens, that we were to take what we needed for just one day, and to rest assured that God would provide the following day for whatever our needs would be. He showed his love for us when he takes whatever we have, whatever gifts we have, and even though we may not be palatable, he makes us good. Yet we also came out of our journey, the bread for the journey, with the most important lesson, and I'm sorry Gwen's not here, but she was the one that always said, if you remember what her week was, more than bread,
we need Jesus.
What a lesson that was, that more than things to fill our stomachs, we need Jesus to fill our entire lives. And we all agreed, we do need Jesus. The crowds that welcomed Jesus on Palm Sunday would soon cry for him to be crucified. Our world seemed to be spinning out of control. Our Savior had come and given us hope. Now he was going to be crucified, and perhaps even the followers would be the next. Changes. We talked about how change is so uncomfortable, so unsettling, and sometimes unfair. But change always happens. Few stood at the cross as Jesus was crucified. Many were already hiding in fear. But Jesus' lack of support at the cross did not change the plan. Crucified, dead, buried, hope had vanished before their very eyes. But then, 3 short days later, there is yet another change. Hope is restored once again, but confusion reigns, even among the believers. This morning, as our Easter season comes to a close, we look to a future that Jesus promised us. Listen as he promises the disciples a final gift, a gift that they claimed long ago and one that we claim today as a community of faith. From the Gospel of John, beginning with chapter 15, verse 26. When the Counselor comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who goes out from the Father, he will testify about me. And you also must testify, for you have been with me from the beginning. Now I am going to him who sent me, yet none of you ask me, where are you going? Because I have said these things, you are filled with grief. But I tell you the truth. It is for your good that I am going away. Unless I go, the Counselor will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. When he comes, he will convict the world of guilt in regard to sin and righteousness and judgment. In regard to sin, because men do not believe in me. In regard to righteousness, because I am going to the Father where you can see me no longer. In regard to judgment, because the prince of this world now stands condemned. I have much more to say to you, more than you can bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will speak only what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me by taking from what is mine and making it known to you. All that belongs to the Father is mine. That is why I said the Spirit will take from what is mine and make it known to you. May the Spirit of truth reign in all of us this day. Easter, Lent, and now Pentecost. What a roller coaster. Now, John and the others had no idea what a roller coaster was back then, but especially today and where we are, so close to Great Adventure, I think the roller coaster is a good thing to use as a comparison. The excitement of something new, for those of you that love roller coasters. The thrill of being with crowds of people, the waiting in lines, and finally our time has come. We get onto the roller coaster and fasten our seat belts. We are usually giddy with excitement, especially if we got on the ride willingly. Now, I know that some of you go just to make somebody else happy. So they may already be shaking in their shoes and praying to live through the experience. But you see, when we come willingly, when we step in that line and step on that ride, we're opening ourselves up to the experience, the whole experience, everything the ride has to offer. And that is how we need to come to Jesus. We have to be willing to experience it all. We have to choose to be baptized, choose to open his word of truth, and choose to be an active part of a faith community. And when we do, When we take those steps, we too will be able to experience all that Jesus had to offer. But come only because of someone else wants us to. Or come because we want to be like our best friend or our neighbor. We will not have the same experience. We will be like those roller coaster riders who close their eyes or hold their breath from the very minute the ride starts. We get the terror. They get the terror, but we get the fun because we chose to go on it. We can see a God who punishes us, one who destroys or one that stays so disconnected from his creation if we don't understand God. But if we embrace all that God has to offer us, we see a God who loves us, a God that cares for us, and a God that walks with us every day of our lives. It's a mixed blessing. We want to ride the roller coaster, but we don't want to wait in the line. Sound familiar? We want to enjoy Memorial Day, but we hate the crowds and we hate the traffic. We want to be blessed by God, but we don't like that we're supposed to love one another, especially when someone has offended us or disrespected us. You can't have one without the other. As Jesus spoke with his disciples about his leaving them, they were upset to say the least. In our scripture lesson this morning, they didn't ask where Jesus was going as they had done before. They were already grieving. They were grieving the loss, the anticipated loss of someone they loved. But Jesus is telling them, this isn't the same thing. For it's in your best interest that I leave. Something better is going to happen. It's not the same, but it's going to be better. And it can't happen unless I leave you. You should be happy I'm leaving you. Because when I leave, the Counselor, the Advocate, the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit will come to dwell in you and among you. And you will be blessed, more blessed than you've ever been before. Sometimes we have to endure the present to make it to the future. Sometimes parts of us have to die so that new things can emerge. Sometimes we have to stand in lines so we can enjoy the thrill of the ride when it's our turn. We have to be part of the crowd so that we can see the parade as it passes us by. Mixed blessings, all of them. Many times Jesus told his disciples they would face adversity, that there would be trials and temptations, that they would be loved, but they would also be persecuted, just like Jesus was. But it says, Jesus tells them, it's going to be worth it. I promise you. On Memorial Day, we remember the loss of life of so many who have paid the ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. It too is a holiday of mixed emotions. We're supposed to remember the pain and the death that was experienced by so many. Yet we celebrate. We celebrate life and freedom that has been given to us. On Pentecost, we remember Jesus' death. But we remember his life from Bethlehem to Calvary. And we celebrate his promised gift of the Holy Spirit. For it lives within each of us and it empowers us to continue to do the works that Jesus began. Come to Jesus willingly. Be willing to stand in line, ready to take the ride with our eyes and our hearts wide open. Experience the fun and the fear, trusting in the one who is at the controls. Don't come just because. Don't come and go through the motions with your eyes closed tight, just going through the motions and never committing yourself to the ride. Being a disciple of Christ is a mixed blessing. Jesus never promised that the way would be easy. Jesus just told them that he was the only way. And Jesus promised that he would always be with us, that we would never, ever be alone, even when we felt we were struggling all by ourselves. Thanks to Pentecost, Jesus' final promise comes to light. The Counselor has come, and no matter what, we are never alone. Amen. The Holy Spirit comes to us not just to make us feel good. The Holy Spirit comes to us to empower us to do the work that Jesus began on earth. The tomb is gone. God's work is hanging on those doors back there. We're called to serve God's people. Let us use that power, that presence of the Holy Spirit, and reach out as Jesus reached out long ago. Amen.